Mrs. Quayle, your husband is one of the youngest people to achieve such high office and has been one of the most criticized. How do you support him in those two areas?
First of all, I don't think he's been criticized as the vice president. I think all along the role he's taken and the job he's done, if you read the press reports, anyone who studies it and follows it gives him accolades for the job he's done, this handling of the Philippine crisis when he was the president was out of the country and he was handling that, the work he's doing to support the president, the work he's doing specifically for our party, he's doing an exemplary job in all of them. So he doesn't need support in those areas because the president was right. He picked the right person for the job, and Dan's doing just wonderfully. But everyone, when you reach this level, needs to have support from someone who they can trust. And I think that there isn't a president or a vice president who hasn't relied on their spouse solely for emotional support, because you can't get it from anyone else, because it'll be in the papers. You really, unfortunately, can't unload yourself on anyone except your partner.
Your husband's job has precluded you from practicing your profession, law. Are you too busy to miss it?
I would say I went to law school with a lot of people, and not all of them are practicing law either. They're in areas that are of interest to them. The important thing about a legal degree is the way it teaches you to think, and that never leaves you. I now have what I consider to be a legal brain, legal thought process, and I use that in everything I do. And when I'm practicing law, I may have an impact in a year on maybe 100 people. In this position, I have an impact to make a difference for millions.
There's been lots of talk about someone else being the presidential running mate in 1992. Do you worry about that?
No, not at all. Not at all. It's the president's choice, and the president so far is very happy. He said so, and he's also said that Dan's on the ticket. The media has to have something to speculate about, and this has been going on. They did it to George Bush with Ronald Reagan in 1984. They've done it with Carter and Mondale. It's Washington. It's something to fill news time and to make a story. I don't think it's anything very serious, and no, I don't waste my time worrying about it.
We hear very little about Tucker, Benjamin, and Corinne. Can you tell us about them and how they're feeling about their dad being Vice President of the United States?
They're actually doing great, thank you. We're blessed. They're delightful children. Tucker's a junior in high school now, and going through the throes of getting his driver's license, which has been an interesting experience for all of us. Adding the Secret Service and all of that, it's been unique, I think. And Benjamin is a freshman in high school. He just started a new school, so he's back in school with Tucker. They're in the same school, and he plays on the freshman soccer team and is having a good time. And our daughter, Corinne, she's in seventh grade and doing just what girls do. She's a sweet child. She's really a wonderful child. They all are. We're very fortunate. I think having lived in Washington basically their whole lives, it was much easier for them to adjust to their father's new job than had we come directly from Huntington, Indiana. They've grown up with congressmen and senators and going to the White House and all that is Washington that might have been overwhelming. And they had friends. They just moved across the river into a different house and different schools. But as far as being overwhelmed by Washington, no, they didn't have that, which is good.
How have the kids adapted to the Secret Service?
Better than I thought. I think you've got to look at it from a child's perspective. I think they did better than I did. I was used to being independent and jumping into the car and going and doing, and now I really can't do that. I have to give 15 minutes lead notice and all of this stuff. But the kids, since none of them drove, were always dependent on an adult to get them somewhere. And we lived out in a rural area of Virginia, and they always had to make appointments with friends. Friends had to be brought to their house, or they had to be taken to another child's house. So now, instead of relying on their mother to take them places, they've got Secret Service that are a lot more fun than their mother.
You know? Are you ever able to just sneak away?
What's that?
No. There's no such thing as sneaking out. Many of our viewers didn't know too much about Marilyn Quayle until your husband became vice president. Can you tell us about your growing up years?
My growing up. I'm one of six children. We were born and raised in Indianapolis, Indiana. My parents were both physicians. And it was just a normal, everyday Midwestern upbringing. We lived in town, rode our bikes everywhere, and did the public schools throughout grade school and high school. And then in college, I went to Purdue University and then Indiana University Law School. I worked my way through school. And law school, I went to night school, worked during the day. In college, I had every job imaginable, you know, waiting tables, teaching swimming, teaching everything I could do during the year and during the summer, assessing houses for the tax collector. You know, some very interesting jobs to get myself through school.
You've been working jointly with our industry, the National Association of Broadcasters, on a very special concern of yours. Tell us about that.
I've been working with the National Association of Broadcasters specifically on breast cancer and breast cancer awareness. And we've been involved for almost a year now on breast cancer awareness campaigns, and I've done public service announcements that have been aired, and did the Race for the Cure in Washington, D.C. for the cure of breast cancer. Then I speak all over the country on breast cancer awareness. There are so many women dying of breast cancer, 42,000 a year, which is really needless. It's especially rewarding for me because my mother died of breast cancer, and if her breast cancer had been detected early, then she might still be alive even now and have been able to share in all of this excitement. So any little bit I can do to prevent that happening to someone else is very rewarding and special.
Do you learn a lot from Barbara Bush?
She's a wise lady. She is. She doesn't give advice, but I sit and listen, and I do learn, and I learn from watching her, which is good. But she's great fun. She's really a neat lady.